Queensland's health minister will meet with dozens of women today who were left injured and traumatised by their treatment at one of the state's hospitals. Jessica Millwood is in Mackay. Jess, good morning. It comes after a damning report.
Good morning, Alex. It was late September that the Health Minister travelled here to Mackay to deliver the findings into an investigation involving the obstetrics and gynaecology services at the Mackay-based hospital. Those findings were damning. It found that substandard care at multiple levels led to the deaths of three infants and for multiple women to be injured. They are traumatised. At the time, the Health Minister promised that she would come back here to Mackay to answer any questions that they have. That will happen here today. Today at the CQ University, where she will hold a forum. There are plenty of women here that have plenty of questions, including Monique. She had a hysterectomy early last year. She now lives in constant pain and needs complete reconstructive surgery following that procedure.
I don't know the last time I was happy or I felt happy, because when you're in so much pain, it clouds everything.
I've spoken to a couple of the women ahead of this forum. Specifically, they're going to be asking what is being done right now practically inside the hospital to ensure that this never happens again. And Alex, some of those women will join us here a little bit later in the show.
All right, Jess, thanks so much.
Now to one of the biggest public health failings in Queensland's history. Three infants died, dozens of women injured and traumatised by the treatment they received at Mackay Base Hospital. An investigation of obstetrics and gynaecology services finding women were provided with substandard and inadequate care. Today, many of the patients will be wanting answers when they meet Queensland's Health Minister at a community forum. And some of those women join us now, including Jessica Beasley and Mel Ferrier from Mackay. Thank you all of you for joining us this morning. It's been a long fight to get to this point. Jess, if I can just go to you first, because you first raised concerns 9 years ago after losing your son Nathan, but you weren't listened to. What do you want to hear from the minister today?
good morning, sorry. Look, I am here for every woman and every baby, basically. I want to hear that we're going to be listened to, that more women are going to be acknowledged, and that there are going to be actions taken to prevent this from happening in the future to anybody else.
How hard is it knowing that for 9 years you weren't listened to?
I can't really put that into words. It's something that I always knew that my care was inadequate. Having that confirmed 9 years later isn't really, I can't put that into words. I'm here for, like I said, for the future, for every woman, not just here, but this needs to be a nationwide thing. There needs to be change everywhere, because it's just unacceptable that, you know, that lives are taken and that women are abused and permanently damaged.
And, you know, and so many stories that just reading through that report and hearing what so many of you have gone through, I can't believe that we're talking about a hospital in this country. Mel, you found out that the surgeon who botched your surgery had multiple complaints against him. How are you now?
Still going down the road of recovery, more surgery, more investigation to find out what they can do to fix what he messed up, especially in his old school methods of how he was operating. And as a senior teaching surgeon, it's just horrific that that's what he was teaching the new generation, is the way that he operated on me, and it's not right. And that's one thing that I'm hoping will change.
Have you been able to get your head around this idea that here is a doctor who had multiple complaints against them? He was actually stood down that afternoon, so Mel, you were his very last surgery. How the system allowed, I mean, this is, you had patients for years raising concerns about some of the practices at this hospital. You had midwives trying to determine when to schedule some surgeries so that their own patients wouldn't have to deal with these particular surgeons or doctors. How is it that that went on for so long and was never stopped?
That'll be one of the questions I'm actually going to be raising with the minister today, is what was their process of recruiting surgeons and consultants into the Mackay region, because it's not the only surgeon that they've stood down, particularly recently, who has come from another group or hospital where even back there complaints were put against them. So obviously there was no review given to their past performances, and the lack of leadership and commitment from their leaders and management to resolve any issues, and they've just brushed them under the carpet, or they weren't even listening in the first place.
Mel, how is your health now?
And it's still a progress, so it's definitely not 100%. I still struggle most days with a few issues that have arisen from the surgery in relation to the bladder that was cut and also the scar incision that he made. So it's, every day is a challenge. So, but you get through it at the moment the best you can until it's fixed.
I'll tell you what, you're all incredibly strong. Just for you, because, look, nothing's going to bring your little boy Nathan back, but can any words make up for what happened to you, and what do you want to hear today?
No words can ever fix, or bring my baby back. Look, I'm not the only one this has happened to. I really urge anyone that has gone through a similar experience, no matter where you are, to have the courage to come forward and share your story, and don't stop fighting until you're heard. I guess I want to hear that women are going to be listened to. If I was listened to back then, the several times that I spoke up as a 19-year-old first-time mother, my child could possibly be here. So I don't want that to happen to anyone else. I don't want anyone else to suffer the way that I've had to. I want to feel confident in that that's what is going to be happening in the future is...
Look, no one should go through that. Five beautiful faces I'm looking at right there who've gone through a lot, and there are going to be a lot more at the community forum with the health minister today. I hope you get the answers you're looking for, and appreciate your time this morning. Thank you.
Thank you guys for having us.
The WA government is trying to avoid strike action from nurses by promising to introduce nurse-to-patient ratios in hospitals across the state. Lucy McLeod is outside Royal Perth Hospital. Lucy, good morning. It's been labelled an historic reform, this.
It is, and that's because the government has finally agreed to a nurse-to-patient ratio of 1-4 in the mornings and afternoons and a 1-7 ratio in the evenings. They've got 3 years to implement this, but only 12 months to figure out if this is an appropriate ratio for the emergency department and also for our regional hospitals. What they're also offering is a $3,000 pay rise, or 3%, whichever is higher, over the next 2 years, as well as a $3,000 cost of living payment. What the ANF initially was pushing for was a 10% pay rise, but walked that back at the weekend, signalling that if they agreed to that nurse-to-patient ratio, they could come to some kind of agreement. And after months of back and forth, Alex, we know now that 97% of the United Workers Union has agreed to accept Mark McGowan's offer.